Since Professor Chiming is not here to introduce me, I will introduce myself fast as I will try to do it so. My name is Ioannis, or my American name, John Toliopoulos. Studied in Chicago, United States, when I was 18 years old with a full scholarship there. And I was lucky to go there because I had my left foot good. So I had full scholarship from the university because my father was very poor in order to handle this high tuition and fees. Then I went to medical university in Hungarian school in English. Then I did my PhD in cancer immunology, where I have to show you some of the results. And then I was trained, as I said to Professor Michael, with the best immunologist in reproductive medicine, Professor Kulam and Ruzev in Chicago. So the last 9 years I do it professionally in Thessaloniki in my own research center that I'm president. And it's a non-profit foundation and carries my father's name, Konstantinion Research Center, for my father, Konstantin. I honored him and I named it by this. What I will have to tell you today is the role of NK cells with antioxidants and electromagnetic fields in metastatic cancer patients. It's an in vitro and in vivo results to give you an idea how we handled a final end stage cancer patients and how we gave them quality of life, which is the major issue of this conference today. We extended their life expectancy rate. When the oncologists, the classical oncologists, were telling them in 3 months, you will face death. So let me tell you some key words first, which will be my presentation tonight, today. NK cells, major issue for me. Four, cancer of immunology, and the second issue where I got trained, the reproductive immunology. Antioxidants, electromagnetic fields, and the fourth one, flow cytometry, the technology where I'm very, very expert in combination of this to conduct targeted clinical laboratorial projects now. And at the end, which will be very important, it's what we set right now, the presence and the future of immunology of cancer. We will set 25 monoclonal antibodies in diagnostics, and this way we'll managing the therapy and we will improve the quality of life. So stay tuned for the end, I would say. Natural killer cells. Dr. Thorwaite in the early 70s, he discovered the natural killer cell. And it's, everybody knows it's a subpopulation of lymphocytes, 15% of the white blood cells. And they have a tremendous lethal capacity by releasing, killing in all the invaders of the human body by releasing perforin, granzymes, and by direct apoptosis. And it's very important that they're considered, since even that time, the brain of the immune system. That's a nice picture that I want to share, the way that NK cells, they grab and surround the cancer cell. I remember from my project, 27 NK cells were the maximum in order to kill, to surround and kill one cancer cell. Unbelievable information that we had at that time. So what did this natural killer cells opened a new horizon for the cancer immunotherapy? Many, since the last at least 20 years, as I remember, very various NK cells-based immunotherapy approaches. And I categorized them in three stages. First one, the administration of stimulatory cytokines antibodies to patients. We will have in the afternoon a nice speech by a professor for this specific event. It will be very interesting to see it. I remember Dr. Michael, one Greek doctor in Germany, was sending me samples in the lab. He was applying this therapy. and I was checking the phenotype. So I was seeing the increasing of the NK cells or the NK T cells on his samples. It was very encouraging treatment, but I didn't follow, you know, the clinical results for his patients. He's still in Germany. I just don't remember his name, from A, I think. Very successful doctor in Germany. Second one, the adaptive transfer of NK cells. There's a lot of bibliography also for this. And the third one, which my project is depending on this, the stimulation of NK cells by antioxidants. The latest many, hundreds, I would say, papers in NK research, so I don't have to stay here. I mean, if you check in the bibliography in PubMed or Google Scholar, you will see hundreds of bibliographic references for NK diagnosis, therapies for cancer, and many stages of cancer. What are the antioxidants? Substances that can prevent or slow damage to cells caused by free radicals, unstable molecules that the body produces as a reaction of to environmental and other pressures. We call them also how? Free radical scavengers. And the sources of the antioxidants can be natural or artificial. The effect of the supplementation of 13 different antioxidants and their analogs of, as a single agent or in combination with chemotherapy. We've seen so far amazing papers about up to today about 174 reviewed original articles from 1965 till today, which comprise about 93 clinical trials, which a cumulative number of a big number of patients, 18,208 patients, 56 animal studies, and 35 in vitro studies. The data suggests that the antioxidant has superior potential of ameliorating chemotherapeutic-induced toxicity, and also the supplementation with antioxidants during chemotherapy also promises higher therapeutic efficiency and increased survival times in patients. But I come to Professor Michael's presentation that is this enough? Can we read hundreds of papers and we can just give antioxidants to our cancer patients and give them a better quality of life? It's a big question. And I remember you had many question marks with all this. So in my opinion, I will state in the conclusion, it will require a combination of things in order to be individualized things in diagnostic and therapeutic approach of the cancer patient in order to improve his quality or her quality of life. Now we're going to another topic that I used in this project as an introduction. What are electromagnetic fields? Pulsative waves, electric and magnetic fields in a perpendicular angle of 90 degrees, which usually emitted where? In the nucleus of the Earth. And it covers our whole planet with a frequency of about 70.8 hertz. If the electromagnetic wave or the electromagnetic field was zero in our planet, what do you think would be able to exist? No. The Americans made measurements. They know every single time how is the electromagnetic field in our planet. The way, if you know why the ice melts in up to North Poles, is because of the changing of the electromagnetic field a little bit. We don't know how it will change in the next 1,000 years. Maybe the life will change that we don't know how. Already in the North Pole, some biological animals are not existing because of this change of the electromagnetic field. So how important is for us to use it? In diagnosis, in therapy? We'll see. The information, though, is that every cell, tissue, organ, nerves, arteries, genes emit in completely different frequencies, which means that they resonate in the Earth's electromagnetic field, having as a result the stability of the physiology of our organism. So we can have diagnostic part which is targeted individualized testing, but we can have also a therapeutic part, and I can tell you the information that they have been discovered more than 5,000 diseases with frequencies. I have to also add that many studies have been reported in solid cancer tumors with electromagnetic fields. Not only in vitro, but in vivo also. We have also a big amount in bibliography of electromagnetic fields. The one paper I remember, the one journal that we published some time ago, the Electromagnetic Biology and Medicine, has unbelievable reports with electromagnetic fields application in vitro or in vivo. For your knowledge in the future, you can go and see it to have some extra knowledge or information how this field also can affect or can help as a beneficiary for the cancer patients. Basic background for flow cytometry. Three components for the flow cytometer: fluidics, optics, and electronics. It's this system that helps me a lot to conduct any kind of research or any project that you guys want to do it in your daily practice in order to see how your therapy goes. Applications, hematologic malignancy, immunology, many applications. Reproductive medicine, I use it. Transplantation, microbiology. And that's what I told you just before. They can help many scientists, many scientific specialists to be informed in order to investigate their patients in the proper and accurate way, like we said with Professor Michael before. Targeted diagnostics for targeted individualized therapy. Let me give you a few words about the project, in vitro and in vivo, that I used. We identified substances that stimulate NK cells against cancer cells, or even to kill selectively or directly without affecting the human cells. And the second one was to evaluate the result of therapies of cancer patients with solid tumors based on the methodology of NK cytotoxicity assay that I set with the flow cytometer. The therapies included the administration of biological substances, which most of them are antioxidants, and the exposure to electromagnetic fields to the patients, and the administration of chemotherapeutic agents. We had a combination of this in some patients. But the major issue is to investigate, I will state in my conclusion, the new antibodies that will lead in more precise diagnostic evaluation and more targeted therapeutic approach for better quality of life for the cancer patients. And this is the major goal for this conference. We tested about, for each category, 12 healthy volunteers, and we evaluated the natural cells activity with administration of antioxidants with flow cytometry. The in vitro experiments included measurements, the in vivo with the cancer patients, we included measurements of the number of NK cells and the number of the NK T cells plus the NK cytotoxicity assay in the cancer patients before and after the exposure to the electromagnetic fields. As control group, we considered the NK number and the function of the volunteers before treatment with the EMFs. Furthermore, as control, we were used also publications concerning NK functions in cancer patients treated with chemotherapy or radiation. Why did we do this? Because no bioethical committee that we got approved here in Athens or the Hellenic FDA will give us to use control cancer patients. That's why we use this. And it was an unbelievable experience because we had to go through hell, in quotation marks, in order to have this project to go, especially here in the Greek territory. For the in vitro experiments, we used the antioxidants we tested, ascorbic acid, resveratrol, cupressus semirivirans, viscumalbum, vanadium cysteine, and vanadium putrescine, which were complex antioxidants manufactured by the chemistry department of the University of Ioannina. Also, I have to mention the collaborations that participated in this project. The chemistry department of the University of Ioannina, the clinical laboratorial lab, physiology department from the Medical University of Ioannina, the AHEPA University Hospital, and my foundation, Konstantinion Research Center. So it's a lot of combination collaborations. Morinda Centrifora and Noni Premium. I was expecting to be the same, but when I tell you the results, it wasn't the same. Jenny Stein and Aloe Vera. The concentrations that we tested were these three dilutions. The methodology, four stages, where we isolated the NK cells from the whole blood, then the target cells with a target cell line K5062. I have to tell you my comment about this cancer cell line and the vision we can give to the surgeons by using different cancer cell lines after the surgery, and that would be a good, important feeding for them. The incubation with these cancer cells and the NK cells at these three ratios, and the measurement of cytotoxicity with a FACS scan Becton-Dickinson flow cytometer. We have to note here that at the third step, we added the antioxidants. These are the fantastic histograms that we had from our flow cytometer for the cytotoxicity assay. Here are the cancer cell lines mixture with a different concentration, and here we see in the three different concentrations the cytotoxicity with the accurate percentage that can show us for 99.9% accuracy with this technology. And I was amazed with this accuracy. This you can see it in most papers, the NK cells and the NK T cells, how we see them from the flow cytometer, just to have a vision for this. The results. We see, that's why we were amazed with these two compounds that the chemistry department did. We see about amazing percentage, 590, especially in the low ratio 12 to 1, which means automatically boosting on the immune system in this low concentration. That's why I wanted to stress this efficacy. Resveratrol, very good compound antioxidant. And we have in our hands a paper of 50 pages now, which resveratrol, it's one of the therapeutic mean that my clinicians use for the cancer patients, and amazing results we can see in the future with this. Also, this is an important compound because I don't know if you guys know, there's an international conference just for resveratrol. the compound, the complex compounds, we have very good results. Viscomalbum was also very amazing results. The other two concentrations, the 25 to 1, we see in most of them we have increased. The 50 to 1, I neglect to make any comment, because if I have many NK cells and just a little cancer cells, automatically they will kill them because of the mechanism that I said in the introduction. So the only comment I have to make, and I was very surprised about this, was that this Noni Premium, which is Morinda Citrifolia extract, it directly killed, without putting in NK cells, just the cancer cells with 90%. So the stimulation was just 10%. It didn't affect, it didn't stimulate my NK cells. And I was amazed, that's why I concluded in this speech. So they may be substances, I don't know, in the universe or in our planet, that they can kill directly cancer cells without affecting our white blood cells or the population, which is very important for the immune system. That's why I have this important result. Now, for the pilot study for the 15 end-stage cancer patients, these patients were exposed at low-intensity electromagnetic fields at radio frequencies ranging from 60 kilohertz to 29 hertz for 8 hours every day for 6 days per week for 4 weeks. And we measured the number of the NKs, the cytotoxicity of the NK, of the NK cells, and also the NK T lymphocytes versus the cancer cell line. And then everything was measured by the flow cytometer before and after the exposure. Now, listen carefully to this. The patients had completed their chemotherapy, radiation, and the antioxidant therapy, and we used all these complex therapies according to their body weight. We had some bibliography that we got some reference from old professors that they use these antioxidants, and that's why we use this. According to the protocols for patient eligibility, the requirements indicating that chemotherapy or radiation has to be stopped at least 4 weeks before the exposure of the cancer patients to electromagnetic fields. And that was a bibliography that we got from Rochester et al. In 2004. That's why we stopped the chemotherapy and we did this project with the exposure of electromagnetic fields. Patients received no medications during the study. The type of malignancy and stage of cancer was confirmed by histological and the regular classical oncological means that everybody knows. Also, we performed some standard biochemistry tests, the classical ones, alpha fetoprotein, CEA, and CA19-9. This was by investigator named Kostas Havelas, who invested the device that we used in our laboratory in physiology department. It's a multi-channel dynamic exciter with a dipole, antenna, a sophisticated computing system, and a Faraday cage. Just to show you. The type of cancer and metastasis is in this group. You see the ages were from 38 to older one, 79. And also we had a very young lady, 28 years old, with different metastasis. You see here the adjuvant therapy with the antioxidants, some of them, because of the results we saw in vitro, we used the chemistry's department complex with vanadium cysteine and vanadium putrescine. Some of them received chemotherapy, and some of them did not. This is a table that we had to report that the exact frequencies that we used for the exposure. And we published this. That's why I show it to you in detail. And here's the results for this 15 patients that we see increase in the NK cells after the treatment. We also see the cytotoxicity increasing in most cases, especially in the low ratio concentration. So we figure out that the exposure to electromagnetic fields does not only stimulate the NK cells, but also increases the number of the NK cells. That was a big achievement for this project. So sometimes we were looking out in the in different extracts because of the chemotherapeutic agents that they decrease the number of the NK cells. That was a reason that, and we showed this, that we boosted the bone marrow to produce more NK cells. So with the appearance and the addition of the antioxidants, the cancer patient was fighting much better and better. Comments and discussion about this. The methodology of this exposure to EMFs applied in the present study has been previously shown by us to exert significant anti-cancer effects either on malignant cell lines or tumor-bearing experimental animals. We did it before with animals. My project was the first one in Greece that used electromagnetic field application in humans. And that's why it's a very significant beginning of this study. The recent studies indicate that the EMFs applied on human body through needle-like electrodes, which are posed on selected body sites, may increase the activity of the natural killer cells. This phenomenon is related to the regulation of the expression of certain genes, which also is reported to play an important role in NK cell activation by Kim et al. In 2005 was reported this. There's also the possibility of an interaction between chemotherapeutic and electromagnetic fields, as it is already known according to the literature. Roche et al. Said this in 2007. However, furthermore, it's very important to emphasize that the observed patient's improvement stated the reveal during the exposure to period of the electromagnetic fields. After this month, 4 weeks, what we did to the cancer patients? We stopped exposing them to this device, but we kept continuing the antioxidant therapeutic efficacy. And that's why most of them, when they were condemned by the classical oncologist to die in 3 months, some of them lived to 3 years, 4 years, some others in 5 years. And that was a big achievement for this study. In conclusion, increase the number of cytotoxicity of NK cells, which seems to be critical for prolongation of the survival time and the quality of life at the end stage cancer patients, may contribute to the beneficial effects of the electromagnetic field and the radio frequencies. The NK cytotoxicity assay, I have to make a mark here, can be used to investigate modified NK function found in various disorders and to evaluate the effects of drugs on NK activity. Why do I have in parentheses K562? Because in order to be more precise in which antioxidant we have to give to the cancer patient, why should we use only the cancer cell line K562? What I advise the surgeons, after a solid tumor, they remove it. What can be done? We can identify this tumor, culture it, and save this cancer line and work with therapeutic in vitro results, which will be the best therapy for this individualized patient. That would be a future project if we get clinicians to work with this issue, dear colleagues. Then we can go to specific individualized treatment, which instead of going just with one cancer cell line. Why, if this cancer cell line doesn't affect the individual cancer patient? That was my also comment when I did this project to my professors in the medical university. So to all of us, if you know any surgeons that we can use this project and we can make it even much better, I think it will benefit the scientific society much more efficiently. Also, the antioxidant substances are very important immunomodulator factors. They just boost the immune system. They don't boost or stimulate the bone marrow. That we have been proven it in the past. So be careful with the antioxidants, how to use them, and what is the role of the antioxidants, especially for the cancer patients. Complex substances that don't cause immunodemulation and kill directly, like the one that I told you before. And maybe there are other substances like this that can kill directly, we have to investigate in the future. So it's a good, maybe Chinese herbal herbs. The herbal in Chinese tradition, maybe they have a substance like that they have to investigate there in this society. So it's a good message for them too. Now here we're to the bottom line. The presence and the future of cancer immunology and also anti-aging, dear colleagues. Our clinicians, after several years of investigation and having packs of columns and hundreds of bibliographic references, we made this rough draft with antibodies And we categorize them, even though some antibody can be in different, two or different categories, depending on the bibliography, because it will be advancing. So we can control the metabolism of the cancer by checking this in the lab, all these antibodies, the multiplication of the cancer, the epithelial mesenchymal transition with these antibodies, the metastasis with all the pathways, the adhesion, and the survival of the cancer. I have to give you the information. Nobody in the world has set all this in the lab, in a daily routine. We investigated. We are now ready. The 18 of them were close to press a button. We're waiting for a fund from a donation. And we will have them in a daily practice in our foundation in Thessaloniki. So, not only in diagnostically, but my clinicians have, for example, a combination of therapies like resveratrol, curcumin, and hesperidin. And there's a professor in the pharmacology department of in Thessaloniki who was, she was in Switzerland, in the University of Geneva, that we will search combination and synergy of these three compounds in order to regulate in the cancer patients all these antibodies. And the seven of them, we will set them with ELISA. But let's start with the 18, which were very close. I think it would be an innovation and a revolution in the daily practice. And the important message I have to give you is that we will have the possible low cost because we won't have any funding to pay for the antibodies. What is the target group for this project with the antibodies? Business companies we can help to try and find herb extracts, like the herb Chinese extracts, in order to test them without testing antibodies, without testing antibodies and manufacturing new biological products in order to prevent or manage cancer. Also, our clinicians will be guide them very, very precisely how to use them. Second, laboratories can work with us, can collaborate, that would like to have this diagnostic test and inform their doctors that deal with cancer patients. Third one, hospitals or clinics that they would like to test the efficacy of their treatments with chemotherapy or not. Fourth one, medical tech firms that promote diagnostic testing in hospitals. And fifth one, pharmaceutical companies, if any, that they want to test their drugs for cancer treatments. What are the benefits of using these antibodies, I just tell you? Number one, specific evaluation for the therapy of the cancer patient. Specific diagnostic approach for the use of targeted therapy. Better management of the cancer patient. Control and prevention of even management of the metastasis, which is very, very important nowadays because it's very difficult when we have metastasis to have the survival and the quality of life of the cancer patient. And the fifth one, potential evaluation of new therapeutic projects, drugs, herbs, all other substances. And the head, I talked to with Dr. Chiming with my head clinician. He's a very brilliant, low profile, and he doesn't show up in conferences, but he's working like he was 20 years old student. He sent me last night the last important 2019 information. Why the mechanisms in resistance to immune checkpoint blockers? Why does the checkpoint inhibitor chemotherapy not work to all patients, like Dr. Michael said before? And we had all these quotation marks. Practical applications, what are? Immune checkpoint inhibitors provide durable clinical responses in multiple difficult no-trick tumor types. Second, the tumor microenvironment. Dr. Michael mentioned this. The tumor immunogenicity, the antigen presentation, the classic oncologic pathways play roles in response and resistance to immune checkpoint blockades. By understanding the resistant mechanisms to immune checkpoint blockades, therapies can be developed to overcome this resistance and treatment failure. The combination treatment strategies with immune checkpoint inhibitors are being tested in clinical trials with several antibodies in clinical use. And the last one, the response to immunotherapy may be better predicted by a wide set of biomarkers, what I said before. So, what is our goal, dear colleagues and gentlemen? The goal is to enlighten the scientific community with good, friendly collaborations and to see the cancer patients in the eyes and tell them the goal is not to set to have cancer as a lethal disease, but the goal is to make it a chronic disease. That will be our goal. Thank you very much for your attention.